So I will start introducing myself. I'm Miguel Sanchez Garcia. I'm the barley breeder at ICARDA and the lead breeder of the CJR barley breeding program. And today I'm hosting this meeting where my colleague Zakaria will give you the seminar. Zakaria Kehel is the head of the gene bank at ICARDA. He's a senior, also senior biometrician. He leads the gene bank accession mining and implementation activities at ICARDA as part of the focus identification of germplasm strategy, or FIGS. He also supervises the major breeding data management, and previously he was a biometrician at Biocrop Science in Belgium and a biometrician at CIMET in Mexico. He holds a PhD from the School of Agriculture and Forestry Engineering of Córdoba University in Spain. And I think with this, I will give the floor to Zakaria. Just the last thing I have to say is that since all of us, sometimes we forget the questions, you can load it in the chat as fast when you're getting these questions. That will be great because we will address them at the end of the seminar. Zakaria, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Miguel. Thanks for the audience to be here. I understood that this seminar is for 1.5 hours. I will keep my presentation for 40 minutes or so we can have more time and floor for questions. So thank you all for being here. As Miguel mentioned, I will be talking today about mining barley genetic resources for adaptive trade. That world of mining, of course, it looks like we are mining or looking for gold, but it's almost the same because this is a really using the available resources that we have in gene banks in terms of biological material and also available data to look for patterns and look for useful relationship that we can use to take advantage of what we have as the opposition of what we call data analysis, where you actually have a hypothesis and you need to develop an experiment, evaluate, and then validate or not or reject your experiment. Of course, this work is on behalf of ICARDA Gene Bank, but not only, all the discovery breeding part and the breeders and all the collaborators that we work with for the evaluation and the mining of genetic resources. Okay, let me start with the beginning, which is really before having gene banks, actually breeders, because whatever we do, even basic science in plants and biology is really to serve the improvements of varieties for food and nutritional security. Before having gene banks, which actually historically speaking, it's not really far in the history, breeders were themselves, because they have a narrow kind of genetic variation to work with, and every time they need new variation, they will go to the nature and collect material that they think will be helpful for them in crossing and then breeding program. This is what we use in general to assess a breeding program, what we call the breeder's equation, which is mainly a relationship between the cycle length, how much time does it take you to finish one cycle of breeding, the intensity of selection, the accuracy, how much you are really accurate as a breeder to select the best of the best, and also the genetic variance. And as you can see, most of those parameters, as far as we know, are really, you know, limited. We have cycle length where you can use shuttle breeding, speed breeding, and other technologies, but you are still limited. You cannot, apart from some simulations that we see in scientific publications, you cannot go and do more than what the nature can give you. Yeah. And it's the same for the other parameters. However, from genetic variance, we still hold a lot of genetic variance that it's really not identified or can be used. So we're doing this process in breeding, as I said, mainly what we do, we cross, we evaluate, we select best line or best parents, and genetic variance is really highly positively correlated or linked to that equation that help breeders increase the genetic gain. So the background, really, most of breeding program now lately, they use really a constant repertoire of alleles. We know now that elite by elite is not working all the time, not working for high biotic and abiotic stresses environment. We know for sure that future advance in breeding will be limited by lack of genetic resources if we keep just working by elite by elite. We don't want diversity, and that's very, very comprehensive. Like we know that people, if you don't need diversity, you don't use it. Knowing that most of breeding program took them decades to take out from their program what we call not useful diversity, but we assume that we will be ready in the gene bank to collect the information that will be needed somehow in the future, and we are sure that that will be needed. There is an increase in knowledge about the value of genetic resources, both in ex situ conservation, ex situ collection, which are mainly collections or seed collections or gene bank, but also looking at the diversity that still need to be collected, looking at gap analysis and the collecting expedition, etc. And we are lucky that lately we have a huge technology in terms of the evolution of integration between spatial statistics, GIS, genomic, that we can go beyond what we know and look everything related to molecular ecology, geophylogeny, and also biogeography. So what we know for sure is that we have two conflicting patterns between seed collections in gene banks and elite breeding material. What's an advantage for us in seed collection is that we have large diversity, the size is big, and we have the availability of seed. However, for the elite breeding material, we have a big knowledge about the material, like information and data. We know that it has been big selection pressure. Availability of seed is not always there because, you know, in breeding program, we don't keep the seed forever, all the seed that it's going through the pipeline. So those two are conflicting, but they, of course, they work together and they communicate together. So yeah, there is a problem. There is a problem, but there is also opportunity that we hold in gene bank. If we look at the size of the barley collection, so we have, I think until yesterday in Genesis, we have 200 something thousand accession in most of gene bank that are documented in Genesis. We look at, for example, our case in ICARDA, we hold the third one. We still see that only 40,000 of them and a couple of less than 100,000 are actually wild and traditional cultivars, land races. And you will see that this is important because everything we are doing and talking about in this seminar is linked to the wild and land races, because that's what really useful for us to tape into allelic reservoir richness that we have in gene bank. So yeah, that, most of the time, that's the as a gene bank specialist or working in gene bank, we get this kind of question: I need some seed of gene bank, and then, you know, you almost get crazy and say, "What do you mean by that?" And I'm just having an analogy between a supermarket where you go, imagine you don't have any labels and you need to find a, you know, a piece of butter or bottle of milk, or in a library where nothing is really labeled. So we need to do some order here and show that we can actually label everything we have, and we can reply to requests in a very good manner, really, and with high probability of success. So linking, when you get that question of giving me some seed from gene bank, you need to see what traits you have there. And there are several methodologies apart from the obvious methodology that a lot actually of gene banks are using, which are just a random selection or based on taxa, knowledge, etc. So if we know, if we want to know really our gene bank, we need those kind of methodologies that we are using, or possible massive phenotyping. This is very good. I mean, you go and you phenotype in the field everything you have in gene bank. That's very good because you will enrich the collection with a lot of information. But the problem is that it's very expensive, resource consuming. We have the issue of G by E. That means you need to evaluate not only in your station, but other locations, depending on the traits, and also which traits can I just evaluate for everything. that's not possible because we don't know what kind of traits the future users will demand. We have what we will be talking a little bit in this presentation, which is focused identification of germplasm strategy. We're just looking for high probability for adaptive trait. We don't do evaluation and we target the trait. The user is a king. He said, I want this trait, and we help him focus in a smaller subset. The problem is that sometimes we have issues with diseases virulence and also the availability of global layers, because we really use environmental and soil GIS layers that we don't have necessarily with high accuracy or high precision. We have core and mini core collections that are massively used and are still used. It's easy to evaluate. You maximize diversity in a small set, but it's most of the time you are missing rare alleles, and you focus on small set of the collection. That means you keep distributing only that small set and you ignore the rest of the collection. GWAS and marker-assisted selection, very easy if you genotype everything or you characterize genomically all the collection. You can rapidly scan the entire collection for the successful or positive alleles, but you need to genotype. That's a problem. Even though we hear a lot of presentations and speeches that genotyping is cheap now, it's actually not cheap when it goes to gene banks, because the size of the collection is high. It's still the minimum you can spend is almost $10 an accession, and also what is the representative sample that you need to genotype in the collection, because knowing the nature of a landrace, it's a population. So I need to kind of represent the variability I have there to genotype, and then I need to keep them so I can phenotype them and link exactly the same seed I genotype to phenotype to be able to link between them. Genomic selection, it's almost the same problem. You limit the phenotyping effort, but still you need to do the genotyping, still the issue of G by E, and also we have a huge diversity in gene bank as compared to breeding program, where you need to have some link between your training population and your validation set. So the ICARDA approach that we are doing really to take advantage and exploit and use efficiently the genetic resources is really using what we have in terms of data. Data can be just as a result from our routine activities, characterization, passport information that we have already in our database based on the information we collect while we are collecting expeditions, and also sometimes evaluation traits or genomic information that we get because of specific project. I mean, this data is there not because we are using it as a routine or generating this data as a routine, but mainly it's there and we need to use it. So we have a collection environment that is characterized by long-term climate profile and soil. We can do a lot of things with that. Once we have some traits, we can use figs. We can look at diversity of trait over space and also look for trait spatial patterns that are useful for the use, but also for collecting expeditions. Once we have some molecular data, we can use biogeography, environmental GWAS. We have traits and allele, we can use marker trait association, genomic selection, and of course, using the whole framework that helping us really to do trait mining and allele mining. So really we are using this full integration between different science and using what's available in our hand by data, and not generating really more data sets. So to use a collection, you need to understand it. We are lucky sometimes for some project, again, not a routine activities that we are genotyping, some of the entire collection. We look at the diversity that's helping us a lot to identify any misclassification, odd patterns. Also, this is very helpful if you look at the graph here. If you look at the graph here, we still see more than 50,000, which is almost 25% of the global collection of barley, not specified. That means we don't know if they are wild or land races or anything. So this kind of genomic study is very helpful to recharacterize those accessions to maximize the probability really and the and the collection that you are using to look for the best allele or best trait you want to use. Diversity has a special entity. We should not forget that when we go collect, we collect in a specific point. That means all the diversity is mediated by natural selection. Of course, we should not forget that in specific case of land races, we have natural selection, but we have also farmer selection or farmer preference. So we use this information really to look at this special pattern, which is very, very useful, and look at how and why those populations are structured and identified in a very logical framework of agroecology or soil or whatever. We also look as a part of the data mining we are doing with the evaluation or characterization data. Again, a land race or wild species are really collected in a specific latitude, longitude. We look if there is special entity of that. Do you have an identity? That land race was collected in that locality because of something. And that's what we are looking here. We are looking at most of those traits that I'm presenting here in this table, including phenology, some seed site, some morphology, including plant height, spike length, and even protein. We saw that there is a high spatial autocorrelation. Spatial autocorrelation means that if I have a land race in this village with these attributes, if I go close to that land race and I collect another land race, or if I have it already in my gene bank, it will have almost similar attributes. And using that relationship is very, very important, because from there we can use that to identify hotspots. Hotspots can be high in the map. High means high values for traits are clustered together, and low clusters mean that hotspot of low values for this. So if I'm looking at something very early in phenology, I will go and look for regions where I have low hotspots for example, days to hidden. If I'm looking for larger seed, I will be looking in the map at high hotspots for 1,000 kernelate, and that will help me go and dig this information in the database and look for accessions coming from those regions. So what to do now? We go back to the first question. Can you send me some seed from the gene bank? Well, yes, I can send you, but I need to know what to send you. How can I make that decision? I need to send you a smaller set that you can find what you want. I'm not sending half of the collection. It's too much to evaluate, but also too expensive for us to regenerate, but also to send just by mailing services. So that's why we have been using at ICARDA what we call fixed focus identification of germplasm strategy. And this is how it started actually a long time ago. Again, looking at the history of gene bank, like breeders want kind of borne toxicity for barley and wheat, and they want to develop varieties for borne tolerance, and they went to this area and found what they need, just looking at the adaptation philosophy of a plant or living organism in general. I mean, if you look at any ebiotic stress, if I want salinity tolerant, I'm sure if I could collect something from saline soil, there is something there. They resist for years to saline soil because they have developed mechanism of adaptation, and that's in a small or easy, simple world how this all started. So very quickly, so what we do here really is, before in plant genetic resources, we use core collection, meaning that we have plant genetic biodiversity, we do collection, we do sampling, we develop core collection, we evaluate, and then we distribute. Here we are doing a completely different approach, where the user is asking for something specific, for trait. We do sampling. What I mean here by sampling, it's really the kind of philosophy or data mining we are doing, and we develop a small set that have the variation for the needed trait. So we are using just the relationship between a trait and adaptation for that trait and the environment of of origin. So if I give you just an example between what we are doing in here in focus identification of germplasm strategy and core collection, it's like if you go to a library having 40,000 books and you ask for a book, but they are not labeling anything, and they would say, well, we selected 10% of this, which is 4,000 books, go there and look at them, maybe you will find what you want. Here, what we are doing, we are trying to label like in modern libraries, where you go and you look by author or you look by topic, and then the responsible of the library will guide you and say, okay, you need to go to this part of the library and this floor, etc., and you will find what you want. So core collection is still very important, but in case you have no methodology or in case you have no information to be used because it's not specific. So this is how we are doing it. If we have data, if we don't have data, we just do what we call filtering to mimic selection pressure trait of interest. We subset, maximizing the environmental diversity. And if we have evaluation data, we just use machine learning algorithms. And we select a subset. That subset, if it's evaluated, we go back and we refine tune the machine learning algorithm, and it's going in circle until we get the best model. And I will show you something in the pipeline. So if I give you really quickly, I will not spend a lot of time on examples. This is a really spot blotch for barley, and you can see what are the requirements to have a really spot blotch. And this is what we are doing in our fix steps. So in general, this is our collection of barley. We go and we compute, we use the phenology to compute based on growing degree days and look at the requirement. We compute all the climate variables that are needed for the requirements, which are mainly temperature and the humidity. We create an index, we filter, and we have the first filter. And secondly, we go to the second stage of the requirement, which is something should be there in terms of humidity and temperature around flowering. We use that to get a subset, and our subset, for example, are the red dots there in the collection that we use and send to our users. So this is a really quickly a filtering example, and I can ask questions in case you have you need more clarification. But as you see, everything is based on phenology. That's why we need to align the climate to the phenology, because all the disease or biotic or abiotic stress is happening at a specific stage of the physiological development of a plant. That's why you need the right data to answer a question. That means we need to align to onset. Onset means really planting days. Day one for me is really the days I planted, which is similar in Morocco or in the UK or whatever. So I can compare day one in the UK with day one in Morocco based on the planting and the physiology of the barley. However, I cannot compare January 1st with January 1st between the UK and Morocco, because it's not the same physiological stage of the plant. So if you can see in this in those plots here, if we use just down temperature, maximum and minimum temperature, if we use just daily temperatures, we don't find any patterns for spot blotch. If we use daily temperature but aligned to planting days, we can see that we have some variables that are important for spot blotch, and those variables are between heading and flowering, and that's exactly what we know in the requirement of that specific disease. That's why ICARDA has developed for most of our crops the onset layers, which are just maps telling you what is the highest probability of planting date for each crop. And we are using that, which is very, very important in everything we do, to be able to form our fixed subset, but also to run, for example, environmental GWAS, etc. So we have also, so we looked at the filtering aspect, but if we have data, we do predictive modeling. Predictive means is a model that helps you predict and not a model that helps you understand. We need to find a function between a trait of interest and agroecological variable, including soil, And then if the model is strong, then we can use it to forecast unobserved collection sites or unobserved accessions in the gene bank. So this is again another example looking at yellow rust in wheat. So we have scores for that, but we have like 20,000 accession of wheat. We evaluate 3,000, but we cannot evaluate everything. So we just do kind of machine learning. We divide those 3,000 into validation set and training set. We optimize and run several machine learning algorithms. We compute metrics. If the metrics are good, that means a model is accurate, which means at the end that there is a strong relationship between environmental variables or environmental characteristics of the collecting site and the traits of or the presence of the traits of interest. So once we optimize, of course, we have this model which has an accuracy, for example, of 0 or 76%. We use that and say, okay, there is a strong relationship. So we can go actually and form model, form a fixed subset based on the new data we have. I want to say that fix is a really specific. This is an example that we did to cross check if it's a really specific or not. This is about barley, and you can see everything in yellow, I mean in the rows, we have the fixed subsets. We have one for net blotch, powdery mildew, leaf rust, yellow rust. We have a core collection generation challenge program. And on the column, we have all the diseases that we evaluated for. And you can see that every big subset, like net blotch, we found only resistant line for net blotch. We evaluate for yellow rust, we didn't find any resistant. The same for powdery mildew, the same for leaf rust, the same for yellow rust. It's very specific to the disease or traits that you evaluated for. Only exception here, you can see that core collection, we can find some resistance in some of the disease, but most of them we don't find any resistant. And that's why I'm mentioning here that Sphinx is really specific to answer a very defined request from the user on a specific trait. So we use that information once our machine learning algorithms are very accurate. We can use them to kind of assign a probability of success to a land race or any other accession we have in the gene bank. And that's what we call here using fixed subset to do predictive characterization. That means you don't characterize in the field. However, you use the machine learning to assign probability and you predict the characterization. So whenever a model is accurate, we apply it to all the accessions that they were not evaluated, and then we can give them a score of success for a specific trait. And this is how it looks, for example. So we have augmented figs to include genomic selection. If you know, that's what we call now Fix Plus. If you know that genomic selection is really using the genomic relationship between land races or line to really kind of predict the value of the one that you did not evaluate. So here what we are using, rather than using only the genomic relationship matrix based on genomic information, we are complementing that with environmental relationship matrix as kind of genomic relationship. I mean, those characteristics from the collecting sites are kind of fingerprinting, because they are really giving you an idea about the behavior of a land race. So I'm merging two kind of matrices to increase the accuracy in the prediction. We saw, for example, in this example of seed characteristics or seed morphology for wheat, we saw some increase up to 15% in some traits. Sometimes it's only 7%. Well, we got some criticism that it's only 7%. Why you are doing only this? Well, actually, I need to do that to increase my accuracy by 7%, because I'm not adding any cost in my studies. I'm just using what's available. So if I need to do genomic selection on gene bank accession, I have passport information, I have access to environmental data, I just add that to genomic selection model, and they increase accuracy by 7%, which is really not insignificant. So the other thing we are doing to add value to gene bank, of course, using genome-wide association studies. Those are examples of barley for protein. But also we are using what we call environmental-wide association studies, which is really, rather than making trait marker or trait allele association, we are trying to link a variation in allele to a variation of an environmental factor from the collecting site. For example, here, if we see that we have some kind of alleles that they are linked to annual mean temperature, that means I have a probability that those accessions that they are having those positive alleles, they will have adaptation to the increase to annual mean temperature. So we are still in the process of identifying those accessions, excuse me, and also do post-validation in the field to see really if the environmental GWAS or EWAS is really giving us the same thing that we are getting by fix. However, doing the environmental GWAS needs a really genotyping again, and that's something that we are looking for, unless really the genotyping is ready for use and was, you know, done for other purposes. So here I will just share with you quickly how we are doing that. So imagine somebody coming to us at ICARDA or in a project, they want a net blotch for barley. So they want a subset. They cannot evaluate 17,000 accession from ICARDA land races. So we did some filtering, as I showed you in the example. We come up with a small subset. We evaluate that. Small subset means 150 to 200 maximum net blotch. We evaluate them. We got some data. We run a machine learning algorithm to link the data to the climate. The model was not that good. I mean, it was only 50% precise. 50%, that means you have only 50% chance to be correct. But even with that very, very non-precise model, we developed two other fixed subsets. One positive means fixed subset having a high probability of finding resistant to net blotch. One negative means having a high probability of finding only susceptible to net blotch and also the crop collection. So if you see, there isn't a big difference between them, even though, you know, the positive selection, we still find a lot of medium resistant MR. But in general, we did not see a significant difference between all of them. However, as I said, this is based on machine learning algorithm with a very, very mediocre accuracy. So the second step, what we did, we got more data, plus new data, plus the old data. We ran GWAS and genomic selection. Genomic selection accuracy was actually quite high, almost 80%, knowing that the size of the population was small, 400 land races. We could identify some good markers, SNPs markers in several barley genome, mainly in 4H, 3H, 5H, etc. We found some positive alleles, even if you see that the effect is negative, you know, because the score is going from 0 being immune to 9 being highly susceptible. So we found very good alleles, very highly linked to net blotch. And then we composed 4 subsets. One subset based on machine learning, we called it fixed validation. One based on the prediction from genomic selection, GS, and one based on selection that we did based on the presence of positive or negative alleles, what we called here GWAS negative or GWAS positive. You can see that in general, looking at the R, which are resistant, genomic selection is a little bit better than fixed validation. However, we still need genotyping to do genomic selection. I mean, there is only 10% difference between them, not significant. So we get from fixed validation you don't need any extra information about the information you have already in the gene bank. We got almost similar result with genomic selection, where you actually need to go and genotype the collection. And then what's interesting is that if I look at the mediocrity of the model we used actually to choose the first the first one, you know, the precision was very, very small. Looking now at actually when we have additional data, so we are fine-tuning our machine learning performance, and we are reaching 78% of the precision, which is really, really high, significant. So our model for multi-blotch now, looking at the whole pipeline, is much more better. But we go by steps. We have no data. We do filtering. And then we do an evaluation, or we get data from the users. We fine-tune a model until we get a good model. To do this, you need data. And data, we keep hearing data is gold. Actually, data is really useless if it's not linked. If you have a data and you cannot access it, what's the point of having data? So we have this approach that all our data sets are connected together. We should not focus on the systems. We have our own documentation system or GenBank database. We have, for example, GIGWA for genotyping. We can use Germinate. For the passport information, we can use Genesis. I mean, here we should not focus on which database you are using, but rather focus on how to link between databases. You should not focus on the fact that you need to have a database handling all data, but you should, however, focus on how to link between them. So we have a comprehensive system here at ICARDA that it's really linking all the databases so we can fetch the information quickly and take a decision based on data. But to do that, yeah, you need that easy access. So here, I don't know if you can please confirm. So you need tools as well. So here at ICARDA, we have developed a tool for figs, which really kind of an application that can help you get the data from any system that has APR or can be accessed online. You can access first your data, you can look at it, you can curate your data, but this application can be adapted to any system that has online accessibility. Or it can be also used to any single files, that means if you have any Excel file with latitude, longitude, it can work on it. So when you have your collection, you can actually go and get access directly via API to available online climatic or environmental data sets. You can map them, you can look at them, you can see if you see any pattern, and then you can start doing some filtering. Here, for example, if you are interested on filtering based on temperature of January or February, you want the one that they have very, very low temperature. You just go there and you will be selecting only the one that they have low temperature. You can map them, look at them, and this application help you do clustering, PCA analysis, and also developing core collection. So this kind of application that we are using here at ICARDA, we are still fine tuning it to add everything related to machine learning. So we have a component for the traits. And it's open access. That means anybody in this group or beyond this group has access, has a database for genetic resources with online accessibility. With the very small tricks, we can update it to your system. The other thing that we have developed between ICARDA and the International Center for Tropical Agriculture, CIAT in Colombia, is we really developed kind of a substituting tool in Genesis. This is really very important. If you look at the video, this is already there in Genesis. You just go there, you are interested in barley, you go select barley, and you are interested, for example, only on traditional land races. You can filter, like if you are looking at any collection in Genesis, and then what you do, you just go and develop your subset based on several parameters like consecutive dry days, consecutive wet days, for drought tolerance or heat tolerance. So this will help you. We have several indicators for heat stress, photo period, soil indicator, and some crop specific one. I will not wait until the whole video because it's almost five minute length. So this kind of tool in Genesis, it's already available. is there to help you select the best from the whole collection of barley and focus on small subset that you can handle in the evaluation for your research, for example. So yeah, what's important is that looking at the first slide where I showed you a little bit messy kind of supermarket and library, we are trying to have kind of e-gene bank, not necessarily electronic or DNA gene bank, but knowing as much as we can what we have so we can reply quickly to requests based on the information we have. But to do that, you need to organize your data, you need to organize the collection, you need to curate the data. Most of what we are doing to understand the philosophy of adaptation of a plant is based on the knowledge of latitude, longitude, and that curation is very, very important. We have cases where the coordinates from all collections are not that accurate. Sometimes you just find the center of a region or center of country. You need to go back and look at those coordinates to really have more precise information, so you are able to create that environmental profile more precisely. And that will help you increase the predictability with what's available. We can't just go evaluate genomically or phenotypically everything we have in the gene bank. So we have tools now that with what we have, we can actually get the best from gene bank without going and evaluating more. Don't misunderstand me here. It doesn't mean that we don't want to evaluate. We kind of evaluate every time we have resources to do that, but it's not part of our routine activities. So if you don't have access to those funds or access to resources, or you don't have time, or the collection is too big to evaluate for everything, then we have all those methodologies that I shared with you that you can get the best from the collection and the reply to request efficiently. And of course, all this is using global layers in terms of environment, soil. We still, unfortunately, with all the development in geographic information system and remote sensing, and all those technologies, we are still in the lack of precise layers in terms of agroecological characterization of the environment. So I will stop here. Of course, I will thank all my colleagues from different research institutes and also our donors that help us really fund and do this kind of research in mining gene bank accessions for useful and adaptive traits. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Zach. If you don't mind, stop sharing so we can see the hands that are raised.
Ah, okay, that's good. Thanks.
If you want, we can start. There's some questions in the chat. As far as I see, there's from Jamba. Can this be the scope of e-gene bank or more?
Well, I don't know if I understand Jamba. Hi, Jamba. Very well, but if we are talking about electronic, what I called e-gene bank in my last slide, I think. Your question, Jamba, was before my last slide, is really to try to have kind of digital resources. Digital, I mean information, not only data. We need to turn the data we have already in GeneBank into information that help us select the best from our collection. I don't know if that answers your question, Jamba.
Yeah, Zach, thank you for the presentation. So my question was, to try and look at the scope of when we say e-gene bank. So is it only data? What about maybe the infrastructure? What about the other tools, equipment, and everything that will maybe facilitate this easy accessibility and the linkage, I mean, from different data sources?
Yeah, absolutely, Chamba. I think here I was talking only because this is the scope of this talk. I was talking only about the information linked to the gene bank. However, if we go beyond that in terms of operations and also enriching the collection with more data, using sensors and using non-destructive tools for measuring characteristics of seed, etc., that also will help increasing the knowledge about accessions and increasing our, or helping us in our way to achieve this e-gene bank principle.
Anybody else has any other question?
Yes, Jack. Yes. This is Rajnish from IIT. Eh? Thank you for the presentation. Yeah. And are you getting me?
Yes.
So it's still e-gene bank digital. I think digital word is really very big, you know. I don't know how much you are want to accumulate in this, but digital means is coming whatever the genotyping data, sequencing data, that's also digital nowadays. Digital characterization is going on in image phenotyping. So you want to include everything in that information, or you are specific? Because digital is really very big nowadays, you know.
Well, again, it's all linked. Whatever we have, we can link it as far as it's accessible. So we know, and in every domain, we look at, you know, colleagues talking about availability of data. Data is available. Everybody doing research is generating data, but where is this data? The problem is not how to link the data, the problem is the accessibility of data. You have genotyping, you have climate, you have physiology, you have gene expression. Whatever you have, actually, you can link it as far as you have access to this data. So it's a matter of linking data sets to have an answer or to have a question in mind to be able to answer it. So again, looking back at my introduction, I said we are doing data mining. That means we are not generating new data to answer a question. We are using what's available to answer those questions.
Okay, thank you, Jack. Yeah. Thanks for the nice presentation. Yeah.
Thank you, Rasul.
You, anybody else has a question? In the meantime, people are thinking about their own questions, I have one for you, Zach, as well. Where do you see the role of the new technologies in whole genome sequencing, de novo sequencing in the gene bank?
Well, I would prefer to not answer that question just because I don't understand it, right? I can only talk about things that I understand. So the whole genome sequencing, we don't have clear examples of how that's really useful in the case of gene banks, right? We are still struggling with genomics. We have been struggling with SSRs and microsatellite, and now we are struggling with genomic. I'm not saying it's not useful. It's very, very useful. But we still have some issues in using genomics in gene banks in terms of how to link between the seed you are genotyping and the seed you are phenotyping, in case you want to do genomic selection, in case you want to do GWAS, in case you want to do all this. I mean, if we decide only 10 samples from an accession as a representative sample to be genotyped, that means we need, most of the time when we did it, we found differences between them in terms of genomic profile. I mean, their expression phenotypically will be different. You need to keep those seed as they are, as one solution. I don't know, maybe other people have other solutions. And if you keep them, that means, can you imagine how can I increase the capacity of the gene bank we have at ICARDA by 10, multiply by 10, if I need for every accession to multiply by 10 the one that I need to conserve for users to have a really, and to be sure that the one that I'm distributing is the one that I have genotyped. So, as I said, maybe other people have different approach for that, but it's always good to look at research. We are using anything we can find, but I don't have a use case to evaluate that information now. Yeah.
But sequencing is, I think some example are really good, like in the RISE 3000 RISE accessions from the RISE gene bank genome sequencing, they say it was very good and they found some good results for some disease resistance or some other, and similar the recent from the ICRISAT 300 or 3000 in the chickpea, and they said they found how to spot from the drought and something with this. I don't know how much useful, but they said they were, this was useful. But I agree with the Jack, with the gene bank, it's not easy for in the place of the funding, and another is the technology one. How to sequence and then handle the data, bioinformatics analysis and other things, which all the gene banks don't have that facility. Yeah, that's another big challenge.
Thank you. Yes, correct. Thank you.
Thanks, Zach. There's a question also from Luke, but I will let him ask directly.
Hi, both. Yeah, thanks. Really nice talk. Some really nice examples where you're selecting for disease traits by the correlation with the ecographic origin and land. I was just wondering, in your experience, are there traits that are less correlated with the origin of the material? And if so, are there other data sources that you can use to, I mean, think of quality characteristics or something, or other data sources you can use, or data sources that you think would be valuable to generate?
Yeah, thank you, Luke. That's a very important question. So most of the cases that we were not successful, meaning that we couldn't find that stronger relationship between environment and the trait, were for traits that they have different pressure or different virulence, about disease, and also everything that it's mediated by pharma selection, especially quality traits. So those kind of traits, of course, sometimes they are mediated by natural selection, but we know that most of the time farmers have been selecting those land races for specific end use quality, and that's why we start combining between, and what we call now fixed plus, combining between genomic selection and fixed approach, and combining two matrices of similarity based on the environment, but similarity based on the environment. But most of the abiotic, biotic stresses, we could actually, for all the crops, find good resistance, again, unless for some diseases where the virulence is not clear, or you have big difference between isolates or something like that. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
There's another question from Adil Mulakat.
Yes, thank you, Zakaria. Thank you, Zak, very much for your nice and very clear presentation. So my question is related to fixed subset. So since we can develop for each, since this is very specific for each trait, so we can develop for each trait, like you mentioned, a fixed for selected accessions for this subset. Mainly for biotic traces, abiotic traces, for the quality traits also. My question is more technically than scientific. For the accessions that are not selected in those fix, why do we have to keep them in our gene bank for a given crop?
I don't need that.
Maybe for genetic diversity studies or just with
No. So, you know, that's why in one of the slides I talked about fix being specific, and I showed the difference between fix and core collection. When you do core collection, you maintain a small subset that you are distributing all the time.
Yeah.
For fix, we are using the whole collection to select a subset. I don't know tomorrow if I get from Miguel, he's asking me about fixed subset for seed length. I don't know which one will be selected. I don't know the winner.
Yes.
It's not. So that's why I talked about specific. That means you never know which one will be the best. And that's why we don't evaluate. We just go use our model or our philosophy of adaptation. And we don't know tomorrow which kind of traits will be asked to deliver. And that's the whole. So your question actually is an answer to the fix, which really means that means every accession in the collection has almost equal probability of being a candidate to be used one of the days. Of course, if we have information about, if you tell me I have an accession, I don't have the species information, I don't have the coordinates, I don't have this, I don't have this, then it will not have a lot of chance to be selected for to be used as a fixed subset. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Zach. There's another question from Arashnesh.
Yes, I have one question about the figs. Just I want to confirm from the Jack. In the fig is from the land race only, or the breeding or wild native also will be the part of the figs? This is my question. Or this is only coming from the land races?
No. It's only land races, because as you can see, Rajniv, it's based on the relationship between the collecting environment and the presence of trait of interest.
Okay.
So breeding material, we don't do that. For discovery breeding, that it's using breeding material, they have their tools in discovery, using GWAS, using allele mining, etc. Here we are talking about mining gene bank accessions, and most of the time when we talk about gene bank accession, we are talking only about land races and wild, and only the one that they have coordinates. If you look at the example of subsetting tool, and I really encourage you to go to Genesis and look at that subsetting tool we developed, you go and you select the collection of barley land races. You have so many of them, but the tool will work only with the land races that they have specific latitude, longitude, because the system need to link them with the environment of origin. That's the
Another question in that, because if suppose some one crop has different species, so for each species you want to make different fig population, or they will combine of the all the species, like some crop like barley, I'm not sure, but some crop are there. There are many species like yam. So there are some 5, 6, 7 species are there. So we have to make a combine from six, or we have to say, we have to go for each species by subset collection. What is your suggestion?
In general, that's exactly what we call specificity. You cannot have one fixed subset working for all of them, because it's based on the knowledge of the disease, and based off the fact that you are trying to find the relationship between the environment of origin and the disease. You can't do that for all traits. Sometimes, for example, in the case of barley, we found, for example, like 5 land races that they combine spot blotch and nut blotch, which are, you know, luckily we find 5 of them that they were resistant for both. But in general, it's very, very specific to the disease that you are studying.
No, sorry, I'm not asking about the disease. I'm asking, saying, because one species, I mean, one crop has a different species, like yam. In the yam, we have 8 and 10 species. That's making the yam. We said yam, rotundata, alata, and something.
But okay.
We have a combined collection of this. We said total yam collection is 6,000. If I want to make a fix from this, so we have to go, my strategy should be species-wise fig collection, or all together?
No, all together we use them. Well, okay. And of course, it depends on your knowledge about the species. But in general, for us here, what we use a combination of all the collection, independently of the species. But as we go in time, sometimes we realize that there is a pattern of some traits. That means the traits will be more in one species and not the other one. But in general, we use the whole collection, because you want to maximize the chance. You should not reduce or focus on one species only.
Like potato and something, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Any final questions?
Not question, just comment. Can we get the soft copy of his presentation for this talk, or I don't know, Jack can decide.
I mean, you will have the whole seminar loaded in the webpage.
Okay. That's great. So we will get the link of this.
Yes, I think. It will be loaded. I think it's in the chat. I mean, Donna, you maybe.
Yes, at the beginning of the chat, there's a link to the recordings. This one will take a few days to go up, but it should be up there next week.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jack. Thank you.
Okay. So.
I don't see any questions in the chat.
There's more?
No, there's one from Lux, but I think
is the old one.
I think he said it by voice. So.
I would just ask, do you think there is there any trade you believe for which fix will not work at all?
No. Well, of course. Let's be honest. There are some people asking for traits that they are not traits, like tolerance to the high temperature at night. Okay, tell me, how can you measure that? Like, I don't know. There are traits. Sometimes people, like, they think about developing something for yield. As far as I know, gene bank is not there to deliver resources for yield, because that's what breeders are doing. We are here to deliver new variations for the traits that they already have in their breeding program, or variation that they don't have at all. I cannot predict which one. It will never work. But yeah, of course, if something very, very, very limited link to the adaptation, it will not work. If something completely linked to farmer preference, it will not work. So mainly you need to have some ecological or environmental adaptation so the strategy will work. If not, it will not work.
Thanks. So I believe with this, we will put an end to the seminar. Thank you very much, Zach. It was really interesting. And
well, thank you for being here.
Thank you, everybody, for attending.
Thank you.
Thank you. See you next time.
Thank you, Jack.
Thank you.
Have a nice.
Bye.